In this video, I will be talking about cataract surgeries, that is phacoemulsification, small incision cataract surgery, conventional extracapsular cataract extraction, and intracapsular cataract extraction. In first part of the video, I will be discussing some basic concepts that are important to understand the thought process behind cataract surgeries, and then we will have a surgical video-based analysis of each step. Lens, as we know, is a transparent, biconvex, crystalline structure located between iris and vitreous, suspended by zonules 360 degree, which holds the lens in position. Structurally, it has anterior lens capsule, a very thin posterior capsule, anterior epithelium, cortex, and nucleus. Anterior epithelium and equatorial region forms new lens fibers. Successively, new lens fibers are laid down on older, deeper fibers. Therefore, central part is the hardest and peripheral part is softer. That is, nucleus is the hard part and cortex is softer part. Knowing these hard and soft parts is very important in understanding the logic behind the steps of cataract surgery. So when this clear lens becomes opacified, it is known as cataract, which causes a decrease of vision. Here's an example of comparison between vision of a person with clear lens with that of a person with cataract. As this cataract is for causing blindness, we needed to find some solution to it. The earliest documented cataract surgery was done by an Indian. 3000 years back, ancient Indian physician Maharishi Sushruta did cataract surgery by a technique known as couching, which involved using a sharp instrument to push and dislodge the lens into the vitreous cavity. This cleared the visual axis and gave patient ambulatory vision. Cataract surgery has since then come a long way from couching through intracapsular and extracapsular cataract extraction to phacoemulsification. The types of cataract extraction can broadly be classified into intracapsular cataract extraction and extracapsular cataract extraction. In intracapsular cataract extraction, the entire cataractous lens along with intact capsule is removed. Here you can see the zonules are broken and entire lens is removed. So there is no capsular bag left behind to put a posterior chamber intraocular lens, thus leaving the eye aphakic unless an anterior chamber intraocular lens or secondary IOL is put. ICCE has very limited indications, that is subluxated or dislocated lens, because in these patients zonules are already absent, weak or broken, and if we try to do small incision cataract surgery or phacoemulsification in them, it will put stress on remaining zonules, which can cause the entire lens to fall down into the vitreous. On the other hand, in ECCE we remove the major portion of anterior capsule, nucleus and cortex, leaving behind an intact posterior capsule in which a posterior chamber intraocular lens can be implanted. And these extracapsular cataract extraction surgeries are the surgery of choice for all cataracts except for subluxated and dislocated ones. Extracapsular cataract extraction surgeries include conventional extracapsular cataract extraction, manual small incision cataract surgery, phacoemulsification. We usually use the terms small incision cataract surgery and phacoemulsification separately. And when we say ECCE, we mean the conventional ECCE. But we should know that they broadly belong to the extracapsular extraction group. Comparing amongst the type of extracapsular extraction, as we go from conventional ECC towards phacoemulsification, the size of incision decreases. In ECC, sitting superiorly, we make an incision from 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock position, that is around 10 to 12 millimeters of incision. In SICS, the scleral incision is around 6.5 millimeters. In phacoemulsification, it is usually 2.2, and some surgeons have done it through a 1mm incision also. So because the size of incision decreases, post-op astigmatism also decreases from ECC to phacoemulsification. And due to the large incision in ECC, we need to apply sutures, while SICS and phacoemulsification are sutureless surgeries. But phaco also has some drawbacks like machine dependency, that is, it needs a phacoemulsification machine. While ECC and SICS, all you need is microscope and instruments. And another important point I want to discuss is the use of phaco energy inside the eye. See, in ECC or SICS, we remove the cataractous nucleus outside the eye, leaving behind the capsular bag. So it does not matter how hard the nucleus is, as we are not breaking it down inside the eye, but removing it outside. But in phacoemulsification, we need to break this nucleus, emulsify it within the eye. So harder the nucleus, more would be the energy required to break it down. And more energy means more risk of damage to the structures of eye. Most importantly, the posterior capsule and endothelium of the cornea. Posterior capsule, as we have already seen, is very thin, and little misdirection of energy or touch of phacotip to posterior capsule can result into a posterior capsular rupture or posterior capsular rent, PCR. And vitreous would gain access to the anterior chamber. There is risk of nuclear piece falling behind. Also, we might not be able to put a posterior chamber intraocular lens. And if corneal endothelium is damaged, its pump function, which keeps the cornea in relatively dehydrated state, is lost, resulting in corneal edema and even pseudophakic bullous keratopathy. Note that with advancement in phaco machines, phaco is becoming safer and safer even in hard cataracts. So the choice of surgery would depend mainly on the hardness of nucleus, availability of phaco machines, surgeon's experience, and ultimately his or her choice. The first surgery we will discuss is phacoemulsification. Side port incisions are made at limbus using MVR or V-lens blade. Anterior capsule is stained using trypan blue dye under an air bubble. Excess dye is washed. Ophthalmic viscosurgical device, OVD, or viscoelastic, is injected in anterior chamber. These OVDs, like sodium hyaluronate or methyl cellulose, etc., are very important part of cataract surgeries. They form the anterior chamber so that there is a working space in which manipulations can be done. They protect the endothelium, keep the anterior capsule flat for controlled capsular access. Also, when put over cornea, improve visibility and prevent drying. After this, a continuous curvilinear capsular access is done. Here I am using a cystitome made by bending a 26 gauge needle mounted over a 2cc syringe. In phacoemulsification, the size of rexis is around 5.5 mm. I'm using a Sinsky hook in left hand for stabilization of the globe. A Hoskin or Limbs forceps may also be used for the same purpose. Note that a capsular rexis forceps CRF can also be used instead of cystitome for the rexis. Coming back to our case, a clear corneal incision is used to create main port using keratome. Incision is made by planar by first traveling for some distance in the stroma and then dipping slightly when entering the anterior chamber. After this, hydro procedures are done to divide the lens into three distinct zones: nucleus, epinucleus, and capsule with or without cortex, each requiring different energies to remove them. First, hydro dissection is done by injecting balanced salt solution between capsule and cortex. A fluid wave can be seen passing along the posterior capsule during hydro dissection. Here you can see again in slow motion. After this, hydro delineation is done between nucleus and epinucleus. A golden ring indicates good hydro delineation. Nucleus is rotated to see if it's free. Again, OVD is injected to form the anterior chamber, protect endothelium and over cornea. Then phacotip is introduced into anterior chamber. First, we'll go for the hardest part of the lens, that is nucleus. There are various techniques of nucleotomy like stop and chop, direct chop, divide and conquer. What I'm doing in this patient is stop and chop. In this technique, first a linear trench is made and the nucleus is split into two heminuclei. This was the stop part. Then each heminucleus is chopped using second instrument while holding the nucleus with phaco tip. Note that when chopping is done as the first step without trench and split, it is known as direct chop. And when trench is made in form of cross to split the nucleus into four parts, it is known as divide and conquer. Coming back to stop and chop in this patient. After heminucleus is chopped into smaller pieces, phaco aspiration of pieces is done. Again, you can see for other heminucleus how it is chopped and aspirated. Instrument I am using here is Sinsky hook. If nucleus is hard, a chopper can be used for same purpose. It is important at this stage to phaco aspirate only the nucleus and not the epinucleus, as epinucleus acts as a protective cushion for posterior capsule when nucleus, which is the hardest part, is being emulsified. Now you can see this slightly opaque layer of epinucleus. The phaco machine settings are changed using foot switch because the epinucleus is softer, requiring less energy. Epinucleus is aspirated carefully, taking care not to damage the posterior capsule. The flimsy layer left behind is cortex. OVD is injected, it forms the AC, protects the endothelium, and now also pushes the posterior capsule backwards so that we can take cortical matter without damaging posterior capsule. To take cortical matter, irrigation and aspiration probes are used. You can see that they are blunt as compared to phaco tip, which was sharp. Now you can see the only thing remaining is the capsular bag. OVD is injected. After loading the lens into injector, injector is introduced through the main port. You can see how this foldable intraocular lens unfolds inside the anterior chamber. Lens is dialed inside the bag using a dialer. Viscoelastic removal is done as leaving it behind can cause reaction. Note that another way of proceeding after cortex removal is hydroimplantation of intraocular lens. Aspiration cannula is removed, but hydrocannula is kept inside the eye, which keeps anterior chamber formed and pushes the posterior capsule backwards. Foldable intraocular lens is injected and dialed in the bag. This skips the step of viscoelastic injection and removal. Coming back to our case, after viscoelastic removal, I inject a little pilocarpin followed by air. And then incisions are hydrated. These are self-sealing incisions, so just hydration is enough. No need for sutures. Coming to small incision cataract surgery, sitting position in small incision cataract surgery is superiorly, that is towards the head end of the patient, as compared to phacoemulsification in which the position was temporal towards the side of the eye, which is operated. This superior sitting position and initial steps of surgery, that is superrectus bridal suture, conjunctival peritomy and cauterization, are similar in small incision cataract surgery, extracapsular cataract extraction and intracapsular cataract extraction surgeries. Superior rectus forceps is used to catch hold of superior rectus, and a suture or thread is passed beneath it using a needle held by an artery forceps. Look how the eye rotates downwards when the thread is pulled, giving working space superiorly. To maintain the downward rotation, the thread is fixed to a drape using artery forceps. Conjunctival peritomy is done using a Hoskin or Limbs forceps to hold and corneoscular scissor to dissect conjunctiva and tenons. The bleeders are cauterized using a bipolar electric cautery. A heat cautery can also be used for same if electric cautery is not available. So this step still here, bridal suture, peritomy and cautery are same for SICS, ECCE and ICCE. And the difference now lies in the site of incision. In SICS, a triplanar self-sealing tunnel is made. The first part of which is a frown-shaped incision around 6.5 mm superiorly over sclera using a green blade or a 15 number blade. The reason for this site and shape is concept of astigmatically neutral funnel. An incision within this funnel shaped area causes least astigmatism. So comparing a smile shaped straight and a frown shaped incision of same size, maximum part of frown incision lies within the funnel. And also in case of extension, it would extend posteriorly, which is safer as compared to anterior extension of smile incision. Coming to the second part of triplanar tunnel, a crescent blade is used to dissect a sclerocorneal tunnel. Again, a swabstick, Hoskin forceps or Limbs forceps is used to stabilize the globe during this step. Side pockets are created to accommodate the nucleus while delivery. Cornea is entered till around 1 mm. And after this, just as we did in phacoemulsification, side ports are made at limbus. Anterior capsule is stained under air, followed by wash and injection of OVD. Rexis is done using cystidome or CRF. The difference here lies in the size of rexis, which has to be larger here, as we need to deliver the nucleus out of the bag, while in phacoemulsification we emulsified it within the bag. The third part of tunnel is then completed by entering the anterior chamber using a keratome with a dip, and the section is completed sideways. Hydrodissection is done between capsule and cortex. No point of hydrodelineation here as we are removing the entire nucleus. After hydrodissection, some OAD is put and the nucleus is rotated and prolapsed in anterior chamber. Posterior capsule is pushed posteriorly and cornea is protected using OVD. Once nucleus is in anterior chamber, there are various techniques to deliver the nucleus like Vectis method, phaco sandwich technique, snare. What I use is viscoexpression, in which we inject viscoelastic while depressing the section. And this viscoelastic pressure pushes the nucleus out. Cortex left behind is taken out using a Simco cannula, which has two parts. One for irrigation and other for aspiration. Irrigation is continuous and aspiration is done using a syringe held by other hand. When near cortical matter, piston of syringe is pulled, generating vacuum which causes aspiration. After cortical removal, what remains behind is the capsular bag. OVD is injected. Non-foldable polymethyl methacrylate lens is inserted through the section using a Kelman MacPherson forceps. And then dialed inside using a dialer. Viscoelastic is removed. Followed by pilocarpine, air and hydration. Thread is cut. Conjunctiva reposited. No need for sutures, as the triplanar incision is self-sealing. Coming to conventional extracapsular cataract extraction, initial steps, that is bridle suture, peritomy and cauterization, are same as in small incision cataract surgery. Then a partial thickness incision is given at limbus from 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock position using a green blade or a 15 number blade. And AC is entered. Anterior capsule is stained. OVD injected. The technique of anterior capsulotomy here is different. A can opener technique is used. can see how nicks are made in anterior capsule to create an opening as compared to a continuous recess in phacoemulsification. Then the partial thickness incision is converted to full thickness incision by cutting open the section using a corneoscleral scissor. Little hydrodissection is done. OVD injected. For delivery of nucleus, I usually prolapse it in anterior chamber and deliver it using viscoexpression. Note that the classically described technique in ECC for removal of nucleus is pressure counterpressure method. This method can also be used. Cortical aspiration is done using Simcoe cannula. I usually put a single temporary suture while doing this to keep the AC formed. Then a non-foldable intraocular lens is introduced and dial inside. Viscoelastic is washed, some pylo and air is put. Now, an incision this big needs to be sutured. So around 5 interrupted 10-0 nylon sutures are put. You can see how the needle holder is used to pass the suture while Hoskin forceps holds the tissue. And then suture is tied using a Kelman McPherson forceps and a suture tying. And cut using a 1-ounce. Sutures are then buried, thread cut, and conjunctiva reposited. The last surgery we will discuss is intracapsular cataract extraction. Again, after passing bridle suture, doing peritomy and cautery. Partial thickness incision similar to ECC is made. The next step is to convert this partial incision to a complete incision using corneoscleral scissor. There is no need for staining of anterior capsule and capsulotomy as we remove the complete lens. Technique used here is the wire vectis method. Other techniques are Smith-Indian technique, tumbling technique, erisofake method. As entire lens is removed, there is no bag left behind, so posterior chamber intraocular lens cannot be put. And vitreous also gains access to anterior chamber, so anterior vitrectomy is done. Either an anterior chamber intraocular lens can be put, or a patient can be planned for a secondary IOL, like scleral fixated IOL in second sitting, as was done for this patient. Section is closed similar to ECC using 5-10-0 nylon interrupted sutures.